Good evening to everybody and Ramadan Kareem to our Muslim friends that are here. I was asked to speak about Turkish-Israeli relations, and I think we heard quite clearly from Ambassador Avivi that there is a great consensus in Israel that Turkey is an extremely important country. It's a regional power, and we have been always interested in having good relations with it. This is a constant. As a result of that, I would like to submit to you that the Turkish-Israeli relations are basically dependent upon the attitude of Turkey to Israel. And if we take a look in the past, you know, what happened in those relations, it was always being decided by the Turks, the level of relationship between Ankara and Jerusalem, and not by the Israelis. It is the Turks that determine the type of relationship between the two countries. Furthermore, I think that we are to somewhat nostalgic, because we cherish very much the relationship, the excellent relationships that the two countries had in the 90s, which I'll say a few words about. But if we take a look again, a long look at the Turkish-Israeli relations, we've seen that this relationship, this excellent relationship of the 90s was basically the exception in the 65 years of relationship. Basically, Turkey has always kept Israel at arm's length for a variety of reasons. And despite the fact that the two countries share a lot of interests, but the Turks were never really interested, with the one exception of the 90s, of having high profile relationship with the Jewish state. This honeymoon of the 90s was a result of course, of a Turkish decision. They decided to upgrade the relationship in 92, and they saw that the two countries have many common strategic interests. After the end of the Cold War, and by the way, this honeymoon is a post-Cold War phenomenon, when Israel actually had excellent relations with a number of countries, and the international status of Israel was upgraded by the end of the Cold War, by the American victory. You know, we are the small brother, you know, to the big brother that won the war. And in 92, it's not only Turkey that upgraded its relationship with Israel, it's also China, India, Nigeria, other important countries. And for Turkey, it became a certain necessity because it was thrown back into the Middle East. For years, Turkey, maybe still today, doesn't want to be part of the Middle East, with good reason. During the Cold War, it had a strong enemy like the Soviet Union, and as a result of that, it joined NATO, and it was obsessed with the Soviet threat. With the end of the Cold War, it looked around and found itself in the Middle East with nice neighbors such as Iran, Syria, and Turkey, and Iraq. This threat perception forced the Turks to look for allies, regional allies, and Israel was a wonderful ally, a pro-American country, a country that was considered to carry weight in Washington, a country that had military technologies that could be sold to the Turks that were not available elsewhere. We've seen this type of relationship, which was very close, between the militaries, between security services, and even to the people. You remember the earthquake diplomacy. At that time, Israel was very popular in Turkey. Turkey at that time also had a new sense of confidence. It was mentioned before here, greater assertiveness, greater activism in the international arena. Already then it developed what I call media mania, you know, this, I don't know how to call it, you know, being a realist, you know, a very naive approach to international conflicts, that you can, you know, bring the two people together and, you know, after a while they'll reach an agreement. And they tried US-Iran, Iraq-Syria, Iran-Syria, Syria-Israel, and of course the Israeli-Palestinian. All of them were, of course, a great failure. At the same time, there were neo-Ottoman motifs rising before AKP coming to power. There were people that were speaking about the Turkish century, and Turkey indeed is on the road to becoming a great military power. It built a military industry. Turkey is among the 15 states with the largest military expenditures in the world. So all those elements, to some extent, continued during the AKP in 92, but we see change. First of all, in the domestic environment, there was a new party with certain ideas, a certain ideology, which had some Islamic roots. During that time, it became clear the process of accession to Europe was stalled, primarily because European opposition, and public opinion in Turkey was disappointed, increasingly anti-European. It's not only the Jewish state has problems in Europe, also the Turks have problems in Europe, and they developed anti-Western sentiments, and the AKP to some extent developed, mobilized the sentiments to gain greater domestic legitimacy for the deviation for Kemalist foreign policy. The basic Turkish foreign policy has always been to be part of the West. We see an AKP which gradually deviates from this policy. I'll give you just a few examples about the AKP distancing itself from the West and the US. It was mentioned that March 2003, they didn't approve the opening of a Northern Front it was a big surprise for the Americans. In summer 2008, during the Russian-Georgian War, the Americans faced difficulties in allowing, in getting ships and warships in the Black Sea. The Turks started having military exercises with Syria, Soviet armed, China, which again, no other NATO country had this type of exercises. In 2010, there were Turkish attempts, together with Brazil, another anti-American country, to produce a deal that will take Iran off the nuclear hook. Later on, Turkey voted against the United States at the United Nations Security Council on sanctions against Iran. Turkey gave a hard time to NATO to put its radars on its soil, which could have been construed as anti-Iranian. Nowadays, it considers buying Chinese air defense systems, which will be a huge problem for NATO if they continue with this, and they will buy those systems. There is a great probability that the Americans will simply withdraw all their military forces from Turkey because the Chinese air systems don't have what's called IFF, identification of friend and foe, and there may be a possibility that those system may shoot at American and NATO airplanes. In short, I think that Turkey is no longer a clear, staunch American ally. I think the Americans realize this, don't know much what to do about it. To some extent, it may become even a Trojan horse in NATO. In parallel, the AKP gradually adopts greater Islamic dosage in its foreign policy, a reflection of some of the domestic preferences, symbolic expressions in the current discussion over to become, of, for example, of the Mecca time zone. Who wants to be part of the Mecca time zone? Some Turks are considering it. Mecca is not the center of the world, after all. Statements about leadership in the Muslim world, Turkey a model for the Arabs, which has been already before. To give you just a few quotes, in a speech in Sarajevo in October 2009, Davutoglu, the foreign minister, says, and I quote, like in the 16th century when the Ottoman Balkans were rising, we will once again make the Balkans, the Caucasus, and the Middle East, together with Turkey, the center of world politics in the future. That's the goal of the Turkish foreign policy, and we will achieve it. Significantly, Erdogan's speech after his re-election in 2011 clearly indicates Islamic and Ottoman overtones. Believe me, Sarajevo won today as much as Istanbul, Beirut won as much as Izmir, Damascus won as much as Ankara, Ramallah, Nablus, Jenin, the West Bank, Jerusalem, El-Quds won as much as Diyarbakir. Those are the words of the Prime Minister of Turkey. We can also detect discussions of the renewal of the caliphate in Istanbul to make Istanbul again the center of the Arab world, of the Muslim world, enhanced participation in Islamic forums such as the Organization of Islamic Countries or the D8, Organization of Islamic Countries for Development, clear emphasis on developing economic relations with the Middle East, which are Islamic countries. And of course, Turks have a relative advantage vis-a-vis those countries, and maybe it makes sense economically to do so. What is most striking is that the only Western, only NATO countries that accepted Ahmadinejad for a visit was Turkey. Only NATO country that accepted the butcher from Khartoum, Omar el-Bashir, in 2008 of Sudan. Erdogan defended the Darfur massacre. He prefers, this government of Turkey prefers Hamas to the PA. The dialogue with Hamas started already in 2006. And of course, during Kastled 2008, he joined the radical axis in the Middle East rather than the moderate ones. Of course, it sends the Marmara, which was a provocation against Israel to Gaza. It had relations to Hezbollah before the Syrian crisis. It invited Nasrallah in June 2010 to visit. Turkey of the AKP is welcoming the Arab Spring, particularly the rise of political Islam, the Muslim Brotherhood in a variety of countries. We just heard the Turkish government deploring the military coup in Egypt. And as a result of this type of reorientation in Turkish foreign policy, it dissolves the Israeli-Turkish strategic partnership, which was forged in the 90s. And to some extent, Israel bashing has become a tool in order to achieve popularity in the Arab and Muslim world. And so this has been the situation, and I think that I want to say a few words about the apology, which was of March of this year, which was an attempt by Israel to mend relations with Turkey. The apology didn't meet all the demands of the Turks, but the apology, and I'm entering into the domain of Israeli politics, there was an awareness that the Americans can't do it. We hoped for several months that maybe the Americans will be able to convince the Turks to climb down the tree. But it didn't work because, like the rest of the Arab world, Erdogan smelled the weakness of Obama. And Obama, by the way, when he was 2 weeks ago, half, in Washington, he slapped Obama in public by telling in a public conference that with Obama next to him that he's going to Gaza, when the Americans specifically demand him not to go to Gaza. So we tried the Americans, so we understood they can't work. There were fears in Israel of escalation in the relationship, which we didn't want to happen. I think there was, to some extent, an attempt to appease, maybe is a strong word, but to please the Americans, to please the Europeans that were nudging us in the, let's do it. Maybe there was a hope that the crisis in Syria, which puts Shia mul Sunni world, will bring the Turks back into the fold. This is what we apologize. By the way, I was saying that the apology was a mistake, and 71% of the Israeli public thinks the same. We just ran a poll about it, and I think the Israelis have certain common sense that maybe doesn't exist in certain ministries in Jerusalem. what was the post-apology effect? Nothing. Actually, Erdogan used the apology for domestic reasons by putting billboards, you know, trying
what
to...
What did it cost to us? What happened with the apology? What did it cost to you, other than national...
Did it help? No, it's not a question of national honor. I'm a realpolitik guy. I don't speak about national honor. I try to do things which are useful to my interests. And I think in this part of the region, apologizing for things that you are not wrong about are projecting weakness, and weak people don't get a second chance in our region. I think also we weakened what it cost us. It weakened the opposition in Turkey to to Erdogan.
It was very strong before. Is this your analysis? It was very strong.
Will you please try to quiet down your colleague in the Minister of Foreign Affairs? This is a former ambassador to Turkey, which is... Okay. If I take a look at the future, I think that in the near term, Turkey and Israel will continue to have. Turkey. This is the Israeli temperament here, you know. The future of Turkish-Israeli relations doesn't seem to be very rosy. Turkey will continue to side probably with Hamas, which is a terrorist organization in our handbook and the handbook of most of the Western countries. Gveret. Gveret. Turkey supports radical forces in Syria, which you know, I'm not sure we share the same view about what should happen in Syria. You know, continuation of the conflict is probably better, and we definitely don't want Turkish-related groups on the border on the Golan Heights. About the gas resources, I think there is maybe a Turkish dream about the pipeline to those gases. I think it's a pipe dream. It doesn't make any strategic sense, you know, to strengthen Turkey at this stage. I think that the Cyprus issue will continue to bother the Turks, and we are drawn into this. I don't know if it's very wise to do so. The Armenian genocide will continue to be an issue of thorn, because whatever will happen in Washington, we will be blamed for whatever happens there. I really think, you know, despite being a fellow Turk for years, that the two countries should try to do things that will not affect the future, to be moderate in their responses. But I don't think the future is very bright in the near period.